So good evening, everyone. Today we're here, all of us together, in place of Liu Xiaotu from Urbanus. So we apologize because he couldn't come because of the travel ban from Hong Kong. And so what we thought about doing is we invited, you know, all our friends in the industry to come together because we were all here to put up a presentation, to do our own installations. And we wanted to showcase our different ideas, to introduce to you what we do or what we are interested in as firms and what we're actually working on. And so I think we'll just give, at first, a short presentation of our different installations. Hopefully these presentations interest you into looking deeper into them today, tomorrow. And then afterwards, we'll do a short panel and entertain questions from everyone. And we're looking forward to having an interesting and lively discussion. So first, we're going to show you our pavilion. WTA's pavilion is called No Virgins. And so our pavilion basically is something that is trying to reuse or upcycle old materials. And what we've done is we've actually used old Meralco posts, we've used plastic, recycled plastic sheets, and shipping pallets. And then just kind of like said, that material does not dictate what architecture is. And so here's the short presentation for that.
I'm the principal architect of WTA Architecture and Design Studio. I'm the founder and festival director for Anthology Festival. I think the main idea really behind building this pavilion was to kind of like show how we can, you know, build something fast, you know, with a sense of immediacy. And the idea that, you know, we can reuse all these materials, for example, we're using old wooden electric posts, we're using shipping pallets, we're using recycled plastic. And this idea that it's not the materials that make architecture, but rather can actually just do good architecture with any materials that are readily available.
Hey, I'm Ariana Rodriguez. I'm head of guest relations for Anthology 2020, but I'm also in charge of the construction of the Joson Pavilion. Today is day two of construction, so we are in the process of leveling the floor right now and starting to build the walls.
Hi, I'm Ford. I work under Team Will, and we were part of the team that designed and helped supervise the construction of the pavilion.
We had a lot of help from our contractor with sourcing the materials, especially the wood, which was the major component of the construction. He helped us find a supplier that gave us refurbished Meralco electrical posts for the main structural component.
I'm Roman Lapian. I'm the contractor of the Anthology Pavilion.
I love working with recycled material because it's fun. You don't know what's happening, what's gonna happen.
For the pallets, we were able to source a business that imports a lot of paper products. And in their shipments, they use these wooden pallets to carry the load. So what turns out is that this wooden pallet is something that they have as a surplus, which we were able to buy off.
I think this pavilion really shows how we value program in terms of art design, and it's more about the process. There's two things in particular. One is that the program determines the space, not the materials, not the shell. So the architecture in kind of like exists inside the pavilion with the spaces that are being, you know, sheltered, if any, by the pavilion, and not actually the, you know, the shell, which in this case we're using plastic. And this idea that architecture must have a very small footprint. That as we move forward as a species, I think, you know, humanity needs to figure out how we can actually leave, you know, the earth, you know, to the next generation the way we found it. Lastly, one of the things that we thought about while doing this pavilion was this idea that we can actually upcycle and reuse old materials. And these are materials that should be readily found, that are readily available, that can be used by anyone. Materials that are understood by most everyone in terms of like how they can actually be informed by the structure in what they can build. And this learning process, I think, is important in terms of like you should show people how this can be done for them to be able to know that it can be done.
Concept for the whole pavilion was to try and play with transparencies and light. So we did that by using plastics of different opacities, and the opacities are affected by the amount of recycled material used in producing them.
Ako si Arlo Martinez. Ako yung foreman dun sa construction. Challenges dun yun eh, yung hangin masyado malakas. Kaya pagka nagkakabit kami ng plastic, nahirapan kami. Parang pati kami tinatanggal.
Ako po si Marvick Santos. Ang roles ko dito sa pagbuo nito ay karpintero, helper, tas messenger. Sa designs, nagusto mo ma'am yung paano namin siyang pagdudugtong-dugtongin na wala siyang tukot. Kung paano magiging matibay. Parang imposibleng isipin na titibay yun, pero nagawa po na.
Ako po si David Domingo. Ang roles ko po ay karpintero. Ang natutunan ko po dun, talaga,
it doesn't always come in standardized sizes and shapes and colors. It takes a little more effort, a little more love to work with these materials that have already been used before. The palettes are not all the same width. If you look at the flooring, it's not all aligned because that is the nature of the material. So that way, we have to work with it and then learn to adjust.
Funny issue that we had too was that we were not expecting to have wood that was this durable. When we were designing the roof, we had anticipated a much lighter material. So we were afraid that it wasn't going to stand.
Actually, in terms of design, we actually had the whole thing oriented
differently.
90 degrees clockwise, yeah. Right? Or counterclockwise. But then, during the build and when we were
staking
the perimeter of the site, we noticed that it would be so much better if this wall would face the street and would face the Fort Santiago gate, right? Yeah.
Architecture is not about the materials, but about the space. And I think that's what we're really trying to go for here. Kind of the thought it's a perfect space or a perfect place for it, because sitting here, you know, in Intramuros, in Fort Santiago, it's a very nice juxtaposition and a very nice dialogue, you know, that the architecture engages in.
And for the next folly, I would like to introduce architect Paulo Alcazaren and Ning Tan, where they'll introduce their work called Kawayan.
Thank you, William. Good evening, everyone. First, I'd like to thank William. He's done such a wonderful job this last four. Can we give him a round of applause? And I told Ning, my collaborator for this project of ours, the secret is there are three William T's running around. Hindi niyo alam na triplets pala sila. Anyway, let me introduce our pavilion, which is over there by the portal. It's called Kawayan. And it's a bamboo tower, a folly, really, because you climb up to nowhere, but not because we didn't have any intention for it. This folly, which is 4.5 meters tall, is actually a scaled-down version of a competition entry for something we'd put in last year. And it was also bamboo, but it was going to be 32 meters high as part of a memorial and museum for martial law victims. And the reason for bamboo is because bamboo is Filipino. and our architecture needs a new inspiration or recovering a new inspiration. And so we thought of Kawayan, which is kawaii, which is a new wave of architecture, very literal. But this is the master bamboo architect, Ning Tan. Some of you may know her. And the reason we chose bamboo is because?
The reason we chose bamboo was he slave-drived me to do this. No, it's more of the bamboo is, in our culture, 2,300 years old. So it's vernacular, and it's vernacular, it's very indigenized to our culture. But the interesting part now is that all over the world where you have the areas where bamboo is growing, there's an exponential interest in the experimentation of bamboo. So much so that in 1997, when I was interviewed by Shin Muramatsu of Tokyo University, who's an expert on materials, he said to me, "Ning, you know what? People from different countries in Asia are actually doing the things that you are doing." So it's something like it's in the air. And so bamboo's as strong as steel in tensile strength, stronger than concrete in compressive strength. But I think what's more important is that it really reinforces the identity of Philippine culture. And it's a very strong material inside and outside in terms of consciousness.
So thank you, Ning. And what we'll show you are just two short clips. The first one is the installation and how we put it together. And the second one is the inspiration for the installation, which is the competition entry for last year's Freedom Memorial competition. So please roll the first video. So we have bamboo, and one of the other things, reasons why we wanted bamboo is we wanted to close the cycle. The original palisades that the Filipinos had before the Spanish came were actually of bamboo and wood. So now we are reinstalling what was originally the protection for this part of Manila. So now we'll show you the inspiration for this, which is our competition entry for the Freedom Memorial competition, which was supposed to be built in Diliman, Quezon City at the UP campus. So please roll the second video clip.
History is about perspective. It takes the long view, but it also examines the minute markings in time. The Freedom Memorial will be built in a place that's taken both perspectives. The University of the Philippines has been home to many who've taken that long march to freedom during the time of martial law. This bastion of freedom will be a natural birth mother to the Freedom Memorial. What greets you shall be its iconic tower of bamboo, a symbol of the Filipinos' resiliency. Inside, carefully curated exhibits depict the consequences of a single declaration, one sweeping act that disrupted the lives of many Filipinos and profoundly altered the course of a once democratic nation.
I sign Proclamation Number 1081, placing the entire Philippines under martial law.
Through different displays of artifacts, photographs, documents, and objects related to the abuse of power during the years of conjugal dictatorship, the Freedom Memorial Museum seeks to remind visitors not only of the horrors of military rule, but also the courage of individuals who stood their ground, who held the line. Political figures, human rights lawyers, teachers and students, peasant farmers and laborers, priests and nuns. There will be experiential exhibits, like a walk through China Airlines Flight 811, the plane from which Senator Ninoy Aquino was escorted by ABSECOM guards to his assassination at the tarmac. Museum goers will envisage that fateful moment that sparked the end of the martial law regime and the rise of people power. The walk up the Freedom Tower honors the fallen whose names are embedded in its ramparts. Freedom rising. The apex of this path leads to a panorama of the Freedom Park. Beyond the tower and museum, public gardens give visitors plenty of opportunity for contemplation, such as the Freedom Circle, a space for both communal reflection or celebration. As dusk descends on the memorial, its silhouette is revealed. The shape of the tambuli, our pre-colonial bugle. In present day, it symbolizes the call to remain vigilant, to never forget. The skies darken and thousands of lights will twinkle, dotting the park's walkways and trees. A poignant remembrance of those whose lives were sacrificed to guide our journey back to freedom from the dark days of tyranny.
So we should never forget, and we should always never forget also that bamboo is us. Thank you very much.
Our next folly, it's called Cloudscape, and it will be introduced to you by Terence Yu of VisionArch.
Hello, good evening everyone. Thanks for staying up so late. My name is Terence. I'm from VisionArch. So today, I'm going to talk about some of the ideas that went behind our pavilion. If you've gone around and saw that pavilion made out of plastic cups, that's what Cloudscape is. So today, I'm going to share with you some of the things that happened. But you know, I want to thank William first for organizing this event and for inviting us to have our pavilion displayed this year. So thank you, William. But you know, when William called me up, I was a little bit excited and a little bit worried at the same time, because when we were invited to do this, we were actually very busy, and I worried that, you know, we might not put enough of an effort doing this pavilion. And so what we did was we did a competition in our office. This is a picture of the competition, and then we had lots of entries that came in, and we did this, you know, Shark Tank. It's the movie. It's the TV show where you present your pitches. And so we had several teams present their pitch. We did it Shark Tank style, and we asked them the hard questions, and then we had pizza later. But the first criteria that we set forth was, number one, we wanted to create a pavilion that you don't just marvel at and look at. We wanted something that people can engage in, a pavilion that people can interact with. So this is the first criteria that we came up with. And so everyone submitted their pitches, and we came up actually with three wonderful ideas. And I want to share with you some of the ideas that went before, because we almost built some of them and we were excited. Maybe if given another chance, we'll build some of them. So the idea we had three was Ugnayan, Beer Crate, and we eventually ended up with Cloudscape. So the first one, Ugnayan, was this idea that we can build something made out of polycarbonate sheet. If you look at that image on the left, that's the polycarbonate sheet. It's a rectangular sheet with slits in between. And that slit allows the different polycarbonate sheet to be able to attach to each other. So we are able to create like an organic structure like this one that you see at the back. And you can imagine it when it's lit up. It's going to be so nice. But the idea of Ugnayan is that maybe we can create a basic structure right there on the left side. But then we would have a box of polycarbonate sheet at the side. And people who go there can kind of install their own. And we can kind of create this organic structure that can change. You know, in the 3 days of Anthology, we might have three different shapes, three different structures. So we love that idea. The next one is we call Beer Crate. Now, I think the name is self-explanatory, you know. If I ask you, what do you think they were doing when they were inspired to do this? So of course, the guys were drinking beer. Okay, so we thought of making it using beer crates Maybe we can put some price inside and then people can guess which one, put some numbers in there. Okay, so it's also an exciting idea. People can sit on it. Okay, but of course we had lots of questions. What if some of those polycarbonate sheet falls down and hurts someone? Okay, or how many beers do we have to consume to be able to do this? Is it San Miguel Light or Pale Pilsen or Red Horse? Okay. So eventually, we ended up with the Cloudscape, which is the pavilion that we have now. So I want to give recognition to the team, Anna Rose Libang. I don't know if she's here. Anna Rose, can we give her a round of applause? Now, so we started off with that initial criteria that we wanted to explore how people will engage and interact with this pavilion. And we were looking at playing, then you can hang out there, and you can rest there. But the criteria started to expand, okay? Because their team were avid drinkers of, what's that? Yung sagugulaman? Yung pearl milk tea. Pearl milk tea. And, you know, they started to realize that single-use plastic cups are starting to be a big pollutant in our community. And it's causing ecological waste and disaster, and also that's affecting the marine life. And when they did more research, that the Philippines is one of the biggest users of single-use plastics. So the ASEAN countries consume about 3 cups, but Philippines consume about 5 plastic cups. Like when you go to Jollibee or McDonald's, I'm sure everyone consume these plastic cups without thinking about it. And these are single-use plastic cups that you, when you consume your beverage for 5 minutes, maybe you just throw it away after that, that's the length of its lifespan. So the criteria that we came up with, what if we, instead of single-use, we can give a little bit more permanence or prolonged use for these plastic cups? So we wanted to turn something temporary into something a bit more permanent or prolonged use. The next is, you know, plastic cups, there's no beauty into it. It's so utilitarian. What if we can add decorative aspect into it to make it more beautiful and attractive? Okay. And the third is we want to turn something so ubiquitous and so utilitarian into something that is fun, that can bring people joy. So in the end, we came up with Cloudscape. So we have a short video to explain the rest of the ideas behind it. I hope you enjoy this. Thank you. Thank you very much. That's Cloudscape.
I'd like to tell you guys also and say thanks to Jagnus Design Studio. They have the pavilion called We All Shine, and that's the installation you will see on the moat in the water. So that's by Jagnus Design Studio, Sunny Sunga and Arnold Acero, Austria. So now, for the next folly that we have, I'd like to introduce to you someone who doesn't need introduction, but so the next folly is called Multiplicity. It's by Joson, Buensalido Architects. So thank you. Go on.
Good evening, everyone. I'm here to talk about Multiplicity, as mentioned by William. Can I ask for the slide to be put up on the screen, please? So this, I guess, exploration is essentially primarily in a collaboration between myself and the design ambassadors of the office, primarily headed by Noah Sablon. It's a collaboration between us, designers, as well as the builders, called Tyson Builders. And secondly, it's an experiment on what architecture could potentially be moving forward. And I guess that's one of the reasons why we have events like this, so that we could have a conversation of how we can work together and explore ways on how architecture can transform and serve the people for the better. So let me start the presentation. So essentially, it starts with this idea that architecture is dangerously becoming monotheistic, meaning that we're all sort of trying to come up with this single definition of architecture, that it's an art, a science, what is it really, right? So that's why we come to events like this. But the reality is the world is starting to become complex. It's changing at a hyper rate that we can't even keep up with it. So there's a business practice called strategy planning, strat planning for short. And typically, you come up with a five-year plan. But the business industry, what's going on is that people are saying that why come up with a five-year plan when tomorrow or the day after or the week after, there's somebody who's going to come up with a new tech that changes the game altogether that will require you then to come up with new ideas and basically ransack your whole 3 or 5 year plan. And so we learned that for you to become a relevant organization, whether you're an architect or belonging in a totally separate field, you need to be adaptable and changeable and resilient, basically. You need to react quickly, efficiently to the ever-changing world. And so for architecture to move forward, I think we need to accept that the old tradition or the traditional definitions of architecture are, in a way, of course, still applicable, but not as adaptable and resilient with the ever-changing world. So to move forward, we need to, basically unlock it and sort of accept that architecture is really existing in a dualistic kind of world. So to basically convert that line of thinking into a graphical form, this singular circle represents our typical definition of architecture. But the way that we see architecture is that it has a certain paradoxical existence. It has a certain duality to it that it can actually become both private and public at the same time. It's natural because it exists within nature. It needs to exist within the context of nature. But at the same time, it's artificial because we, the human race, basically makes architecture. It's both an art and a science. It's interior and exterior. It's tangible, but more importantly, intangible. It needs to represent, our collective whims, dreams, goals, and aspirations. Social, personal, it's a connector, yet also a certain level of separator as well, especially when it comes to the private spaces that we all exist in. It's spatial, meaning that you go through it, it's experiential, but it's also, in a way, an object, because we look at it, we see it, and it's, ontology is an object, has a function. in the whole, you know, theory of architectural space. It's for the individual, yet it's also for the society and so on. So basically, it needs to exist in the realms of contrasting thoughts, like these diagrams sort of represent. And to move forward, first is we need to accept this level of duality, but we need to mesh it all together so that it achieves a certain level of complexity, so that any kind of any kind of change in the world, it's going to be easy for architecture to sort of react in a hyper way as well. And so that became the main idea, our main critique on what architecture needs to be as we all move forward as a civilization. And so this becomes the space that's made available to us. It's actually on the other side of the moat. And you know, we cut it in half to sort of say that architecture is spatial, meaning it has to be you know, you have to go inside architecture, you have to go around architecture and experience it more than anything. It's a connector because it connects two places, it connects people and so on. But we also carved out sort of small spaces or small sort of niches within that large circle to create or showcase or demonstrate that architecture can be both public, because it is in a public space, it's seen by quite a lot of people. But then by simple manipulations, you can come up with a semi-public sort of circulation space and a private nook wherein you can have more intimate conversations with you know, your friend and other people in general. And so we created this wall you know, to sort of enclose those private spaces to enhance that architecture is space. Because, you know, when you talk about architecture, the negative space that all of the enclosures surround is the architecture. And so we needed to create that enclosure to create that level of privacy. But then we lowered it to a certain level of just enough so that people who are going through the semi-public space will still get a glimpse that there is something that's going on within that wall. And I mentioned a while ago that architecture is both structure and landscape. So we wanted to connect this level of wall to the ground plane and ended up with a shape like this. And then we converted this object into a screen to manifest, again, that depending on how you look at architecture, it can become porous visually, but can become very private as well, especially if you look at it at an oblique angle. And then this next step is we came up with pots, basically a modular sort of can, to again showcase that architecture can have an expressive form, can have a complex form, but it's, you know, it, the way that it's built could also be in an efficient manner. It's modular, so it's both modular and complex. And then this next step is to essentially showcase that yes, architecture is made by us, it's shaped by us, but at the same time, it needs to exist in nature. And so we started to, you know, put you know, plants on each of these canisters to create something like this. So you see here that, you know, you have two nooks there that allow a conversation to occur in the middle of a public space, and you can actually go through it. So this is really the way that we envision architecture to move forward. Of course, it's an experiment, and so we actually posted online that, you know, the main purpose of us critiquing the state of architecture these days is we want to use architecture, or we see the potentiality of architecture as you know, something that can be used for positive change. It needs to not anymore be just about space, about the physical planning and arrangement of spaces, but how can we use the idea of architecture to inspire perhaps the next generation to be part of the solution instead of simply complaining and exuding negative vibes all the time, right? So how can we use architecture to effect positive change for the future generations or even for this generation? And so one of the things that we always try to do with a project, our projects, is we try to respond to context. And, you know, this site is very sensitive in terms of, you know, its history, its heritage, and so on. And so we wanted to introduce something that's not very invasive. In fact, this is the way that you enter the portal across the moat, and you almost don't see our folly, which is, you know, hidden behind aside from the fact that it's hidden behind this statue, right? It's almost like the plants and the softscaping are taking over the shape of the architecture. So it's not anymore about the object per se. It's also a narrative that architecture should start to become more sensitive to nature, not only in the functional ways of, let's say, coming up with sustainable structures like with LEED, with Verde, and so on, but even with the way that we create architecture, especially in the visual expression of it. So it's a short video. You'll see that one of our ideas is that the central axis of this lawn is in a way terminated in our folly, which you see there at the end. So that was taken this morning. And so the idea also is to take this folly, this piece of sculpture, if you may, and sort of transplant it to different locations so that it comes alive. It's not of single use anymore, but this message can actually be spread throughout. So whether it's a developer who has a commercial space, it can actually be sent to those different locations. So this is just to show you how the idea of this architecture being a circulatory body or something that's experienced can be done. And these were shots that were taken by architect Yanni from the office a while ago, who is a very good photographer, by the way. But here you start to see people engaging the space, having a conversation here. But while they exist within the same public realm, by nature of sculpting those nooks within that same circulatory space, you create separation, yet allows an easy connection also between people. And I like this idea that the landscape almost takes over the entire form. You almost don't see the modularity or the complexity of the way that we built the structure. When we approached the builder, we wanted to make sure that it's something that's very sustainably done. So we implored them to come up with, to use materials that are usually scraps on their site. And so the initial idea was to come up with rebars that were not anymore going to be used and use it for the rods of the structure. So we were able to salvage some, but the supply just wasn't enough for that particular job site. And so this was also taken a while ago. I thought this guy was actually going to propose. I hope you did, if you're out there, right? But what it does is it creates different, moments of interaction and connection between people. Thank you very much.
The next folly is called Hulma, and to introduce their folly, Joson of Joson Design Studio is here with us.
Our installation is called Hulma, or to shape. So basically our goal or objective is really to help each of you to shape or how you think of architecture. So basically how you perceive architecture in different ways. I would also take this opportunity to thank William, because he actually helped more than what we can imagine, no? In terms of building this installation, right? So Joson actually talked about this already, no? Duality of architecture. So this is how we actually attacked our installation. So we wanted to actually create a dialogue in terms of how architecture really has these two usually contrasting, no, or opposite, challenging, polar opposites of ideas. For example, Chat, a while ago when he did his talk, he was saying, most architects think with one side of the brain, how could we actually think, to be able to merge our ideas using both sides of the brain? So we wanted to challenge your perception of what architecture is. We wanted to challenge, basically, the techniques of how you implement or do architecture. Is it low-tech, high-tech? Does it need to be either or can we actually learn to meld the two together? There's also the notion of beauty. No? How do you actually perceive beauty? Beauty is very, very subjective. And with our installation, we actually tried to look for ways for you to question, what do you think is beautiful? So we started off with the concept of anamorphosis. So anamorphosis is the creation of distorted images to be able to project on a certain surface and be able to discover a certain shape out of that distorted image at a certain vantage point, right? So this idea has been around for the longest time. There's a story of a competition in Greece long time ago, right? Two sculptors were actually commissioned to create a projection of the image of Minerva on the pillars, on cylindrical pillars. So we'll just call them Guy 1 and Guy 2. So Guy 1 actually started off creating a sculpture, a perfect image of Minerva. Then Guy 2 created a distorted image that they found really ugly and grotesque, right? So what happened when they projected the image of Guy 1's sculpture onto the pillar, it was the one that became distorted, right? Then when they projected Guy 2's sculpture, the distorted sculpture on the cylindrical pillar, then they were able to clearly see the perfect proportions of Minerva, right? So that's basically the anamorphic projection or illusion. So this is an example. Well, this is a sculpture by Hurwitz, The Hand That Caught Me Falling. So basically, you have a distorted shape. So based on a specific surface, concave or convex, doesn't matter, no, you'll be able to create and see that projection. No, so how do we actually translate this? What we did, so we have the physical object and we have the projected image. So we actually deconstructed the object. So we have turn basically the installation around, so we have three tiers, no? So three levels. So you'll be able to actually discover three geometric shapes. So there's a cylinder, there's a pyramid, and there's a cylinder, no? and a cube, right? So if you turn them around, no? So there are like 9 possible combinations, right, to be able to see it. And there's a certain vantage point where you'll be able to discover the shape. So this actually puts into question, really, how we look at architecture. Because we look at architecture as something that's built, permanent, that's pretty. What's built is the perfect condition already. But sometimes architecture comes from very messy processes, comes from very messy conditions. And this is actually what we want to show. So usually, how we create, for example, a square, how we were taught is that a square needs to have 4 points and 4 lines, right? But in terms of anamorphic projections, this actually blurs the line on what perfect image can you actually create from distorted proportions, right? So this is actually how it works. Prior to the heavy rain, I am really sad that the installation is falling apart. No? We didn't really account for the rain. Originally, the slats, no, that would create the image was supposed to be made of acrylic, but the cost was too high. So we ended up using marine plywood. No? And of course, we had heavy rains throughout the 2 days. So now you can still see the insulation, but it's in pieces already. No? So basically, this is how you play with it. No? So you have 3 tiers. You try to look for the best combination, and you actually look at the cylindrical surface to be able to figure out if you're actually arriving at that specific shape. So, for example, we tested it out. Like here, we were able to form the cylinder, or what we call the kebab. Oh, looks like a kebab. So, all right. So, before I end, I want to introduce a team. The team that helped me are students of mine from UP, UP Diliman. So the design team are the guys sitting. We have Jed, we have Luis, we have Steph, and we have Ish. Asia is my ever-reliable assistant who organizes everything. The guys at the back, we have Jethro, we have Ivan, Trish, and Austin. They're actually the ones critiquing the work throughout the process. So in terms of duality, this is actually how we see design as well. That in for you to be able to create a legible and a very purposeful design, you need to be able to accept criticism, and that's actually how the process worked. Right, so we encourage you to play with our installation or play until you have nothing to play with. No, maybe that's what architecture is, right? So we encourage you to think of architecture and rethink how we think of architecture. So thank you.
Finally, our last folly for tonight is one called Multiplicity. It's done by Jonathan Gunn and Associates, and here to introduce it to you is Matthew Gunn.
So good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Matthew Gunn, and today I'm representing the firm Jonathan Gunn and Associates. Today I'm going to be talking about our pavilion called the New Plug-in City in Metropolis, Manila, over water. So it wouldn't have been possible without the help of the firm and my friends, Xavier, Noel, Bien, and Samgyup Kasagasa. He asked to be called that. Anyway, here's our pavilion. So we actually started with the premise, there's a study that's being published right now in which it says by the year 2050, there's a chance that Manila could be, Metro Manila, half of Metro Manila could be underwater. And we started to think about, we started to plot it actually and see the extent of the damage. And we started to think about how would our cities function in such a scenario? And to reach, to develop our idea further, we actually looked deep down and we looked at what's intrinsic to building in the Philippines. So first we looked at vernacular architecture, in which we have a strong tradition of building on stilts, building over water. And next, we actually analyzed the land use patterns in the Philippines from rural to urban. As you go left to right, what you notice is the patterns that you see. The patterns that you see are very organic because they're very individually driven. Like planning over here is a very individualistic process. In which a person takes matters into their own hands. And this leads to this organic sprawl. And this is something quite interesting. And then as we designed, we made sure that like one key aspect to make sure we don't go astray is to establish a clear visual style over here. So, you know, like part of the process, we defined like the exact color palette we wanted so it wouldn't look like, well, chop suey. And, you know, building, we were only given like a short time to build this, and it's something like quite challenging, like the scale of the pavilion. So to do this efficiently, we used computational design software called Grasshopper, in which we scripted how the form of the pavilion would take shape. And so, you know, this looks like a lot of like numbers to you, but essentially what this does is it allows us to create rapid prototyping. Within minutes, after the script was done, within minutes, we were able to create dozens of different iterations for the design. And what's even better with it is that when we built this, it generated a cutting list like for each single piece over here. Like down to the last millimeter, everything is accounted for. And by doing this method, we were able to minimize material waste and cost. And this also allowed us to build really, really quickly. So I guess like some pictures of the construction process, you know, like watching like how it comes together. What's really interesting about this construction methodology is that we were able to build the entire pavilion from scratch, like down to cutting the materials and everything in just 9 days. You know, there's supposed to be a video here. I'll just show it a bit later. So the final form ended up looking something like this. So, you know, taking all those elements, we wanted to develop this hypothetical grid city over water. Like, and, you know, there are several elements of this. We have the space frame, the grid over here. And we actually designed several plug-in boxes over here that each represent an aspect of the city. And so we have like residential, commercial, health, public space, industrial, among other things. And what we wanted to do with this is we wanted to explore how democratized urbanism or like, you know, individual urbanism can affect how our cities are shaped. So, you know, we started exploring with each aspect of the city. We started exploring how our future typologies would function. So here we have residential structures which are built around the central core, and that they adapt, they can shift around. We have public space where in a hyperdense city, we started thinking about like layering each level over here and seeing how this would affect, like how verticality would solve density problems. I don't know what happened to the next slide. Healthcare, in which breaking apart the monolithic nature of like hospitals, we actually conceptualized using industrial drones in which you can actually pick up a clinic and deliver it onto a different site. So, you know, this solves traffic issues. You can't go to the hospital, hospital goes to you. So that's quite interesting. You know, like there were supposed to be like several slides showing the different aspects of the city. I guess it's better to go to the booth because like each of the boxes actually explains the aspects of the city. Commercial spaces in which we designed cruciform towers that can be disassembled using maglev systems. So anyway, what I'm getting to say is, like for this one, we designed the plug-in city that that evolves over time. So the way that it works is the audience comes in, they walk through, they feel free to pick up a box, any box in the entire frame, take it away, reinsert it wherever you want in the city, and slowly you can see, we want to design this as an experiment to see what kind of combinations will arise from this. You know, maybe public spaces would gather, maybe a public space would be near a factory, who knows? And, you know, we want to start conversations. You know, how do you envision your future home? You know, how, like, remove a box over here, like, plug it in, start shaping the city. And I guess I want to end with this question. How will you, like, as future architects, how will you shape your future city? Thank you.
And so the thing that we actually kind of noticed as I was actually watching all the presentations is that, you know, all these ideas are so varied. And so, but in the end, I'd like to ask, of course, like, what would be the core idea? You know, if you can, like, do a concise line. What's the core idea and message of your pavilion?
You know, in essence, I think that we need to, because architecture is starting to become divisive. So I have a stand. I have a stand. My stand is better than yours. I think we need to shun that thinking and start to, you know, work together. You know, things like this. Have a discourse on how we can, I guess, collaboratively use architecture as a platform for positive change. Whatever that means to you as well.
In terms of core idea, I think mine with Paulo, it's a collaboration, yeah, right? But the thing is, what hit me hard is that Paulo and I, we went into research, really deep research into Philippine architecture to know who we were, who we are, and then you use that to hit to certain avant-garde levels. And this is what Shin Muramatsu was saying of Tokyo. You can't hit to avant-garde unless you really, really know yourself. And I think the nice part about bamboo being 2,300 years old, we have that gold mine to hit avant-garde.
For our pavilion, the core idea is, you know, Philippines is one of the biggest polluter of plastics, and I think it's more of an experiment, you know, if you can use different types of materials that people just throw away and give it a second life, make it decorative, make it fun, then maybe it can inspire other people. It's very easy to do.
I guess for our pavilion, we wanted to like bring the question, I guess we wanted to bring forth the idea of, like, you know, democratized urbanism. It's something that exists in the Philippines. And you know, like for better or for worse, we lack large scale plans, or they're not followed through. So you know, planning is something taken very individually. So we want to bounce back the question to all of you: how would you shape your future cities?
Yes, I wanted to reiterate the importance of collaboration. I'm a bit unusual in that I'm schooled in three fields, but I practice as a planner and landscape architect, and it was a very good collaborative effort with Ning, who was my classmate in architecture, to be able to do this thing. And maybe it also proves the point that I'm definitely, you can see I'm the oldest in the group. So I don't believe in single-use architects. So you have to recycle and reinvent yourself every single freaking day.
I think we're one of the things that we notice is that, of course, as architects, we enjoy doing our pavilions. It can be fun. It can send a message. But something I would like to talk about is what do you think is the difference mainly between designing an installation and something that is architecture? Like, how would you expound the difference of it, and in terms of the design process and the workflow?
I'm not in the practice of designing buildings. I design sites.
Oh, well then.
But it's similar.
Yes.
Similar, but not the same. One thing I want to bring up, though, is the use of the term folly. For those of you who've forgotten their architectural history, follies are little structures in gardens and parks that essentially have no use, or it's not that they don't have any meaning. They do. But these are experimentations and are always meant to try and prove something different or experiment. So follies are essential, and I do want to encourage Anthology to carry on with the follies every year. And I was just talking to Jason a while ago, and one of the other things is that those who are building the pavilions should actually get together in a charrette before the installation, so we can all feed off each other's craziness.
I guess what's most interesting about designing a pavilion is sometimes you can design it to be a bit thought-provoking, to spark conversation. So you don't need to think about the logistics. You do need to think about the logistics, but you don't need to think about pure functionality. It can be a critique of something. It can be thought-provoking, like what we did. Like, we wanted to challenge, I guess, the social norm.
Yeah, exactly. I personally love doing installations because in UP, we've been doing, for 5 years already, we've been doing the hybrids workshop, where we actually create one-to-one prototypes of using computational design. So it's a one-week intensive workshop for students in UP. So we usually create, the last we did was made of bamboo, using bamboo hyperbolic surfaces. So I mean, for me, because it's a good exercise, for quick thinking, you get to produce the result easily. I mean, buildings take so much time.
I guess one of the biggest differences is you're building the installation for yourself, whereas when you're doing buildings, you're building it for a client. So that way, so I think you can be more experimental, you can be more creative, you can express yourself more. Whereas sometimes you have clients that have certain comfort zones and you have to work around that. But with a pavilion, it's whatever you say goes, right?
Except for the budget.
But this is a reasonable size. I think budget-wise, it wasn't ever an issue. And I think there are creative ways around the budget as well.
Okay, for me, it's already the sixth time I've worked with a fellow artist or architect in terms of installation. And one thing I can say is you really have to bond together and then know how to work together. What's very interesting also is the environment is really a factor, like what if it rained while we were installing, etc. So there's a lot of the unknown, no? And then so you have to go on plan A, B, C, D, E, and all of those don't work. So it's a very creative process. You have to know how to dance with it. architecture or construction is more sure. This one is not, but it's of course so much fun, so much engaging, and you should try it. You should all try it one day.
Yeah, so for me, I like trying new things. So like every weekend, for example, and my wife can attest to this, I always urge the family to try a new restaurant, right? Something that we haven't tried before. And that's also one of the reasons why I like traveling. And the reason why I like it so much is I always take myself out of the context. And so that when, you know, I experience new things and I have something to import back to my context. And so with, installations like this, we are taken out of the usual context of the practice of architecture, the calisthenics of architecture, out of our comfort zone, exactly. There's no client. There are no objectives from another person that you have to meet. And you get to experiment so much more. But more importantly, you get to pose more questions about what you do. Because that's the thing about art, because I love art as well. I've noticed that, you know, talking to artists and looking at their work, it's always about questioning your current reality, right? You get out of your current reality, you question it, but it's always about questioning. For us architects, we get so used to coming up with a solution. Oh, this is the brief. What is your solution, architect? And so we get so used to that that we forget the most important first step of architecting, if there's such a term. And that is to always ask the right questions and listen so that you can come up with a proper solution so that we can all progress forward for the better. So, yeah.
I think in terms of, like, we're talking about, like, progressing architecture forward. And a lot of the installations or follies, they're showing, well, new materials. And like, or how do we adapt new materials, and especially bamboo, and like, how is that the material of the future? And maybe we'd like to get your ideas about material, about materials and technology, or even how we use them in terms of like the installations and how what we learn from these follies.
Well, for our folly, it was mostly trying to not really use materials, but to reuse. Or sort of unlearn how we currently use materials. So that's why, as much as possible, we looked at scrap materials, especially the cerujos, right, and found a new kind of use for it. And that's one of the reasons also why we have a lot of different heights, despite the modularity of the cans unifying that. So I think it's about that. It's not always just about using and finding new materials, but it's also trying to find new ways on how to convert old and familiar materials into something better for
us. What do you think inspires this idea of using modules? Because most of the pavilions are doing modules, right?
Well, because of the time constraint you gave us. Now maybe I'll ask.
In terms of bamboo, what's so interesting is that we usually get our influences from the first world countries. And what is so interesting about bamboo architecture is that it's a Southeast Asian strength. And you already see a lot of young architects doing bamboo. There's even an engineering school in Indonesia on bamboo. So what's happening is that there's a resurgence, there's a strength amongst Southeast Asian countries, and it's like just going to the province, no? And then when you get together, you just become stronger. So if you look at what bamboo was 20 years ago, the interest has grown exponentially. No, it's not like this. It's exponentially, and it's being driven by the younger set of architects.
What we forget is that bamboo, well, Ningat said it's very old material. And we, in fact, had the technology of bamboo construction years ago. One of the most interesting finds in conservation by my friend Jojo Mata a couple years ago when they were renovating the Lingayen provincial capital was that the trusses inside that neoclassic American era structure was made of bamboo. So that destroys the notion which has always been ingrained on us ever since that bamboo is temporary, bamboo is a light material,
scaffolding or whatever. It is a permanent material if we just know how to, or rediscover the techniques of using it. And of course, now we have, maybe Ning, you can tell them about how bamboo can be treated to last 10, 20 years construction.
So what's happening now is all over Asia, especially China, first of all, the treatment of bamboo is now a yesterday knowledge, meaning to say everybody knows how to treat bamboo. Number two is how to preserve it. Now China is really, really going so much forward that you can actually put a certain kind of paint material. They call it green. It's a green sealant, and then it will make bamboo last so long. So that's only the beginning. And then, of course, people are finding out how bamboo can be fire resistant, or you can put it in fire retardant level, etc. So it's just a matter maybe of 5 years, and we're going to be solving a lot of problems or fears of clients with regards to how to build with bamboo.
I think the exciting thing about working with new types of materials is because we all grew up with the normal materials, you know, concrete, steel, glass. So we know the properties already, the strengths and the weakness of these materials. But when you start experimenting with new types of materials like the polycarbonate sheet or the beer crate or the plastic cups, then you have to kind of study the strengths and weaknesses of it because it wasn't really designed for such. So we had to look at how do you strengthen plastic cups so that people can actually step on it and things like that. But I think the exercise kind of opens your eyes that of the sort of natural enclosure that were given to us, that the types of materials are those that we are familiar with. But you start to see things differently now because you look at things that, hey, this can be used for something else. And I think that's one of the strongest learnings of experimenting with new types of materials.
Right. Oh, well, for me, how I see it is that old materials doesn't necessarily mean low tech. No? And that's why we have this disparity between low tech and high tech. No? But like specifically how we implemented, for example, the pavilion that we created last year made of bamboo. So it's an old material, but we were able to use more advanced tools of parametrics and computation to be able to create more distinct shapes to make the production of the insulation faster and very accurate. So I mean there are ways to actually marry these two, you know, low tech, high tech.
Actually, yeah. To add on to what he said. Yeah, like it's not only about like how new or how old the material is. It's what's important is to like constantly evolve or constantly rethink how we use the materials. Like you can use BIM, computational design parametrics, a lot of these things to minimize material waste. Like if you're able to get the exact quantity, you minimize the amount of like let's say steel, the amount of bamboo you order, and minimize wastage. And this is something quite sustainable for the future, I think.
Quick question is like, among the pavilions that you've seen or the different Follies, what other one do you think have you seen that sparked an interest in you? Like from the other Follies, like have you in like which one actually you think sparks an interest in you? The different Follies we have here.
There was one booth that had aircon, gave out free coffee, and had a bouncer at the main door. I think I like that one the best. Everyone agrees. Oh, William.
I think we're okay. As a final question, before we go to questions, just to
may I say one thing about building materials? I've always said that we haven't been able to industrialize as a country, so most of our materials is imported. Even though we say it's green, the carbon footprint of most of the materials that we use is actually quite big because we have to bring it in. We had a start of a steel industry in the 1950s, but we never pursued it. So we could have been using our own steel all throughout. It's only concrete and cement that we've been able to do ourselves. We've lost clay and brick which is actually an indigenous, but it's available just like bamboo. We have to force the building industry, the materials industry, to provide better, greener materials instead of just selling us things. And especially now, anything from China is already suspect. I'm sorry. But this is one lesson we have to learn, that we can't rely on bringing all of materials, even the LEED accredited buildings. If you look at the actual footprint of low-E glass, it's much bigger than if we had a proper glass industry. So I think the architects and allied professionals should force government to subsidize more R&D for and subsidize the industry to produce better and greener materials.
I think with that, we'd like to open the panel to questions, if anyone.
Good evening to all of you. My name is Erica. I noticed that you guys had such excitement and a breath of fresh air talking about designing on your own instead of catering to a client. Now, maybe is there a chance that all of you could collaborate on one installation? Kasi ang ganda naman, very bright minds. Why don't you have like a parang just for fun kayo? So that's my first question. The second one, kasi I took up an elective when I was in college. It's called Material Science Engineering. And since you're talking about bamboo, maybe is it possible for your companies to invest in a material science engineering department within your company? Kasi sayang naman kung puro bamboo lang. Parang maganda rin to reinvent. So I remember IDEA, the company, invested in its own IT department. Tapos nagkaroon sila ng sarili ng software and that. Maybe is it time to invest in a material science engineering depth? Yun. So yun. Yun yung two questions ko. Wala lang.
The first question, I think we should just call Boyson. But, no, I think I'm a bit of a contrarian in terms of like materials, because I always feel like we should not be putting our effort into finding new materials. And I always feel like it should, if it's something that should be widespread and used by the general public, then it should be something that people actually know or understand. And so I always feel like it's finding different uses for what we already have rather than looking for new things. That's
I have a what's his answer to what you're saying in this sense. You know, usually when we mentor on bamboo, we hold workshops. And I'm still looking for that event wherein the participants like you can workshop on a design. Correct? What I'm saying is, okay, here's the material, here's what we're gonna do, now let's workshop.
Are you volunteering next year?
No. I'm not volunteering, but I'm just saying that's an idea, because you'll be surprised how what can happen in a workshop.
I think if there are no more questions, we're good. I think. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.